Okay, so let's kickstart our first webinar of the year. I am your host, Juliana Fajardini. I am part of the Suricata and OISF team. And today we will have our, which is becoming a tradition for us, our Outreachy Webinar of the Year. This is the moment where we celebrate and share with our community the results and journeys of our Outreachy interns for the December-March round. Today we have Danielle Eniola Olatunji and Hadiqa Alamdar Bukhari. They will be sharing their projects on adding more rule keywords to Suricata and hardening our code base with code analysis tools. Before we get started, I would like to share a few words about our foundation, OISF, that makes Suricata possible. The Open Information Security Foundation, OISF, is a US 501c3 nonprofit organization that ensures Suricata remains world-class. It is dedicated to preserving the integrity of open source security technologies and the communities that keep them thriving. Our team and our community includes world-class security and nonprofit experts, programmers, and industry leaders dedicated to open source security technologies. Funding for Suricata comes from donations from world-class security organizations committed to our mission. And a list of this organization is available on our consortium members page. If you would like to sponsor us, please check osf.net. Another big news, probably all of you already know, but this year will happen our 10th Suricon. It will be in person again, and it will be in Madrid, Spain, November 13 to 15. Before that, we have the training sessions on 11th and 12th. And if you want to know more about it, check suricon.net. Be there to join the team, talk all things Suricata, take part in the brainstorm session, and be with us for the best Suricon ever to happen. Outreachy, for those of you who don't know what it is, offers paid internships in open source and open science to people who come from underrepresented communities or backgrounds. They are paid internships, as I mentioned. The total spend is $7,000. They are remote, so both the interns and the team work remotely. They last for 3 months and happen 3 times a year, for May to August and December to March. They are open for students, non-students, returnships, career changes, and they are a great initiative for whoever is from an underrepresented community and for the free and open source projects, because these means that we are always learning how to do better in terms of being more diverse and inclusive and knowing how to welcome newcomers. So if you are part of an open source community who wants to know more about Outreachy, do check their webpage, outreachy.org. They have just recently celebrated 1,000 interns. That is a huge accomplishment. So I would also like to congratulate the organizers for this huge feat. And now, without further ado, I would like to invite Hadiqa Bukhari and Danielle Olatunji to have their great talks. I will also share a few words by the end of the webinar as well. We will get started with Hadiqa. Please share your questions in the Q&A session, and we will read and answer all of them by the end of the presentations, okay? Hadiqa? Floor is yours.
Yep. Okay. Hello, everyone. My name is Hadiqa, and today I'll be presenting my project with Suricata, which was increasing Suricata's rule keyword slash log output parity. So a little bit about myself. I'm a software engineer from Pakistan. I have 3.5 years of experience as a data engineer, where I work mostly with Tableau for data visualization, Python, SQL, and ETL tools like Airflow and Talent. I'm also a Tableau certified data analyst, but aside from all the work activities and academics, I'm also a huge movie buff, and I'm an avid reader. A book that I would definitely recommend everyone to read would be The Animal Farm by George Orwell. And a movie, I don't have a favorite movie, but I mean, Godfather is a classic. You can't go wrong with that. So if you haven't watched it, go ahead and watch that in your free time. I'm relatively new to InfoSec. And so far, my journey with OISF and working on Suricata has been amazing. So my agenda for today in this presentation would be to discuss a little bit about my journey to Outreachy and introducing Suricata, what Suricata is. I'll give a brief description of that. I will also explain the project that I worked on and the steps that I took to achieve the goals. I'll be sharing those, and I'll also share some of the lessons I learned in my journey working on Suricata and being an Outreachy intern. So my road to Outreachy was quite a long one. I first heard about Outreachy back in 2019 when some of my friends were applying. They did encourage me to apply, but at the time I just wasn't ready. I was busy with coursework. So I was like, okay, you know, I'll do it once I graduate. And then fast forward to 2022, one of my friends, Halima, she applied to Outreachy, and she was very encouraging. She was basically the one who convinced me to finally, you know, bite the bullet and apply to Outreachy. So in 2023, I started exploring open source communities and different open source projects. And in for the December 2023 intake of Outreachy, I applied, and I was lucky enough to get my application accepted. So once my application was accepted, I started the contribution phase where I had to choose which project I wanted to work on. And OSF, their project on Suricata, was what caught my eye the most. I'd always been interested in network security protocols and computer networking since I studied the topic back in university. And I'd never gotten to work professionally in InfoSec. So I was like, you know what, I'm going to, if there's ever going to be a time to explore that interest, now is the time. So I applied to the Suricata project, the two projects that OISF had displayed. And yeah, working on those projects, I got to learn Rust and C. These are the two programming languages that I didn't have any prior experience with. I had worked on C++ and Java and Python and other programming languages. So I knew coding, but I didn't know the exact syntax that is used in Rust and C. So I was a bit intimidated at first, especially during the contribution phase and how to, you know, navigate that. But luckily, I had a very supportive community at OISF, and my mentors were extremely helpful. So yeah, they guided me through the whole process. And yeah, now I'm going to explain to you a little bit about what Suricata is. So at the core of Suricata, it's an intrusion detection and prevention system. But aside from that, it has other capabilities as well. For example, it provides alerts for intrusion detection, protocol transactions. It allows the user to look at and manipulate network flows, record PCAPs, extract files, and all of this functionality is provided both on-premise as well as on cloud. So now my project on Suricata was to increase the rule keyword slash log output parity. So how Suricata functions is that it logs, it examines network packets that are flowing on the network traffic, and it logs an output against those network packets. And then the Suricata rule language can perform specific functions on those network packets based on the keywords which are visible to the rule language. Now, there was a disparity. The problem statement of my project was that there was a disparity in the fields that were being logged by the Suricata engine. So Suricata engine was recording specific network fields, which are visible in the network packet, but those fields weren't visible to the rule language. There was a huge disparity in that. And my job was to increase the parity between what was being logged by Suricata engine versus what was being exposed to the rule language. Starting my internship, I focused mostly on the DNS application layer protocol. And I also added missing DNS fields in the Suricata schema. Okay. So now I'm going to just share the steps that I took to achieve the goal of implementing those keywords, finding those keywords and whatnot. So the first step I took was to see which keywords are missing. The second was to prioritize the keywords of which keyword I should implement first. The third step was to implement code for those missing keywords in C, create their header files and linking those header files. And then the fifth step was to implement code in Rust. The sixth step was to create unit tests for quality assurance and creating Suricata verified tests along with those. And then finally, wrapping everything up with proper documentation. Okay, so these are just some of the fields which are being logged by Suricata. By the Suricata engine for DNS. As you can see, these are just a few of the fields that I'm showing here. But as you can see, there are loads of fields that Suricata logs for DNS. However, the keywords which are exposed to the rule language for DNS, there were only four keywords which were being exposed when I started my internship. And these were the DNS answer.name, opcode, query, and query.name. So the way that I found these keywords was by running this command on Suricata just to see which keywords were being exposed to the rule language. And as you can see, there's a huge discrepancy. Like there were tens of fields for DNS which are logged versus just four fields which are being exposed to the rule language. So the next step was to prioritize which DNS field I should implement so it's exposed to the rule language. The first field that I picked was, after discussing with my mentors, was the DNS.rcode field. So DNS.rcode is the resource, the response code. The rcode shows what happens to the DNS message that was sent. The value for rcode is it's an unsigned 8-bit integer, which is present in the header of a DNS packet. And the range of values can be between 0 to 23. So these are just some of the examples of values that rcode can have and what those values mean. For example, if the rcode is 0, then it means that there was no error in your query. If the rcode is, let's say, 3, then it means that the domain is non-existent. The domain that was requested does not exist, and so on and so forth. So the second keyword that I implemented was the DNS.rrtype keyword. The RR type stands for resource record type. It gives information about hostname or the domain. The value for RR type is present in the DNS message field, the message body, and it's an unsigned 16-bit integer. The values for RR type can range from 0 to 65,535. Here's an example of some of the values that RR type can have. For example, if RR type value is equal to 1 or A, then it means that it's a host address. Host address is being requested or is being sent. If RR type is 2, then it's a name server and so on and so forth. So now the next step was after analyzing which or prioritizing which keyword I should be implementing, I started implementing code for that keyword in C. The steps I took for both RR type and RR code were quite similar. So today I'm just going to be showing some examples for the code that I implemented for RR type. So I created files in C language, I coded them, and I also created and linked header files for RR type. Here's just a snapshot of the code for RR type. As you can see, RR type is a 16-bit unsigned integer. I created like RR type free function and RR type match functions and the main function. So the next step was implementing that code for RR type in Rust by implementing that code in the detect.rs file. Here's just a snapshot for RR type. Here you can see that RR type can have a for loop is implemented. So RR type can have a DNS query. There can be multiple queries and multiple answers. So the code is iterating through all the queries. And basically if there's a match for RR type, then one is returned, otherwise zero is returned. So the next step was after everything was implemented was to make sure that everything is working properly and do quality assurance. For that, unit tests were created in Rust in the detect.rs file. This is just an example for RR type unit tests in Rust. The next step was to create Suricata verify tests and to see that the rules are working properly. The keyword is exposed to the rule language and the correct value is being returned for a rule. So just to explain what Suricata rule format is, the Suricata verify rule format has three main components, action, header, and rule options. Action just shows what is to be done once a rule is matched with a packet, like a packet matches a rule, what should be the action? Here in red, you can see alert is the action. So it should alert the system once a packet matches the rule. Header shows information about the application layer protocol, the IP source and destination address, the IP, sorry, the destination and source port. The final component is the rule options, which shows the details of the packet, like what the packet content should be, what the flow, which way the flow should be, etc. So creating Suricata verify tests included working on three files. First was using a PCAP file or creating a new PCAP file, which contained the values for the keywords that I was working with. And then the second step was to create test.rules file. And the third step was to create test.yaml file. So here's an example of a PCAP file, which has RR type A, so the resource record type is A, which means it's the host address. So this was a pre-existing PCAP file that I used from other Suricata verify tests. I basically explored all PCAP files, not all, but some PCAP files in Suricata verify, which were being used by other tests and other rules. And I just found out which of those PCAP files had the values for RR type or R code. So the next step was to create test.rules file. Here are just an example of three different tests which were created for RR type. As you can see, it alerts when the packet is of DNS and the DNS, the packet has RR type of one. The third rule here shows negated, it's a negated value rule. So it alerts when the RR type is anything but two. So if a packet has RR type of 1, 4, 5, whatever, it'll alert the user. But if RR type value is two, then it won't. So the test.yaml file for DNS, I've just added a screenshot for that as well. Here I've added the details of the packet, which has RR type is equal to one or A, and the source address and the destination and source and destination port numbers as well. So the output of running these tests were, first of all, I would run make function to make sure that Suricata was compiling properly. And then an Eve output was logged against the PCAP file and the rule that was created. So this is the code that was run to figure out what the Eve output was. I've also added a little video showing the output of running the rules for RR type. So here, first of all, I'm running make. to make sure that the code is compiling correctly. It is. Next step is to run the DNS-RR type Suricata verified tests from the Suricata folder. The next step was to find out what the EVE output was for DNS-RR type in Suricata verify. And yeah, this is the output for the EVE output. Here you can see the packets were for RR type A. It's alerting the user when the packet has RR type one. And yeah, so that was the output. The final step was to document everything properly. Documentation was added for RR code and RR type in Suricata, as well as README files were created for Suricata verified tests. Here's just a screenshot of a documentation for RR type. It explains what how RR type can be used, what RR type is, and the README file in Suricata verify shows the PCAP, which was used to test RR type, and the ticket, which was being used to track the progress. So the final task that I had was to create schema changes. I first did a manual code review to find out which fields DNS fields were missing in the schema.json file, but were being logged by Suricata engine. So the two fields I found were TC truncated flag and SSHFP, which is secure shell fingerprint. I ran Suricata verified tests after adding these fields to the schema to make sure that everything is working properly for quality assurance. Now, finally, after everything was done, there were lots of lessons that I've learned throughout my internship. First of all, I learned how to contribute to open source. I always found the open source world to be quite daunting because, you know, you need to be a very good coder to make such scalable code, which can be used by thousands of people around the world. Using GitHub was another thing that I learned through this internship. GitHub is a very powerful tool, especially in open source. And I'm thankful that I got the chance to learn GitHub from my mentors and how to contribute code through GitHub. I also learned how to run code and write code in C and Rust. And getting to learn about InfoSec and network protocols has been a goal of mine for quite a while. And finally, I got to explore that area of my interest through this internship at OISF and working on Suricata. And finally, I also started blogging through Outreachy. So every week I recorded my progress, what I learned that week, whether it was relating to my project or whether it was just like talking to people in general or about the process of Outreachy. So I blogged everything on my blog, and you can find my blog over here if you want to read about my journey at Outreachy. And I've also added my LinkedIn, email, and GitHub information. If you guys ever want to get in touch with me, feel free to do so. I've added references as well for links that I used in creating this presentation, as well as while working on my project. These are some of the links that I found very helpful. And yeah, thank you for watching the presentation. I'll be taking the question at the end of the webinar. Over to you, Daniel.
Thank you, Hadiqa. Okay. And Yola, good luck as well.
Yeah, thank you. Good day, everyone. My name is Daniel Olatunji. I'm from Nigeria. I'm a cybersecurity networking and blockchain enthusiast, and also I'm a Python programmer. I've been for a while. I started learning Python and been interested in cybersecurity and networking since 2019. And yeah, aside that, I love skating and watching videos of landscapes on Earth since, I mean, I can't travel yet. So yeah, I love watching those, and I love sci-fi fantasy movies and also crime or thriller noir movies as well. And I love reading books and listening to music and spending a lot of my time on a Linux terminal and doing things cybersecurity and networking people do. So yes, and talking about my outreach journey, I was introduced to outreach in 2022 by a friend. And although I was not able to apply in 2022, I applied first for the May-August cohort, but I was not able to be picked. I was not picked for the internship because the project I worked for had some technical issues, so it was scrapped. So all of us applying for that project did not move forward. But for the same 2023, that's the December to March cohort, I applied again. And at first I saw a project, Acilia, and I joined that because it was interesting. And I joined that, but there were lots of applicants joining Acilia, so I knew that was not for me. And then I was scrolling through the project list, and then I didn't even see the name Suricata. I first saw Wireshark, and since I knew about networking, I knew how to use Wireshark, and then I checked and saw Suricata. I was like, okay, I think I should go for this one. And then I joined the Discord, and I think I was the first applicant to join the Discord, and seeing it that way, then I was happy, like, okay, this is where I'm supposed to be. So yeah, that was how I chose Suricata. And from the contribution stage, I learned how to code in C++. I never had any prior knowledge about programming aside Python programming. So I learned how to code in C++ and researched on code analysis. And I also liked that I got to work in a team and a professional environment. I mean, the only time I have worked with a team was during a CTF capture the flag hackathon. So yes, and then my agenda for today is we're talking about code analysis, static application security testing, some code analysis tools, CodeQL, another code analysis tool, and setting up CodeQL in VS Code, and CodeQL scanning and CodeQL query suites, and analyzing the Suricata code base. That's what's my project entails. So we'll be starting from code analysis. What is code analysis? Code analysis is also known as static code analysis, and it involves debugging by automatically examining or inspecting of source code to identify security issues, performance issues, design, and etc., without having to compile and execute the program. And then static application security testing, which is popularly known as SAST, is a subset of static code analysis, and it mainly focuses on the security parts of static code analysis. So it's to identify security vulnerabilities that could leave software applications susceptible to malicious attacks. And at the start of my project, I researched on some code analysis tools that could be used for Suricata, and I got to find FB Infa. You can check it on fbinfa.com, and it's a static analysis tool used to analyze Java, C or C++ language or Objective C to find potential bugs and to prevent crashes and poor performance. And then CLang, which is a compiler, it's popular. It's a compiler for C, C++, and Objective-C, which gives warnings and errors found during the compilation of a code. And then CPP check is a command line tool that tries to detect bugs that a C++ or C compiler misses. It is quite versatile and can check non-standard code, including various compiler extensions and inline assembly code. So, and then after doing my research during for the project, the mentors informed me that there was actually an existing solution for hardening So finding bugs in the code base, and it was CodeQL. So I used CodeQL for the project. And CodeQL is a code analysis engine developed by GitHub. It discovers vulnerabilities across a code base. It makes use of queries, which is as good as if it's read data. And CodeQL can be used in VS Code or on the terminal using a tool called CodeQL CLI, mainly for command line interface. And CodeQL can also be used on GitHub with GitHub Actions, and it's called code scanning. And the next slide holds an example of a query. So this is an example of a query. And the way CodeQL is, you can write a query by yourself. And although you have to learn the CodeQL query language to be able to do this. So to use CodeQL, first of all, the code base that we're trying to analyze has to be, we generate a database that represents the code base through CodeQL. I'm going to show us some ways later on how a database can be created from, can be generated from the code base. And then after generating the database, then we run CodeQL queries on that database to identify problems in the code base. Now, there are lots of queries on CodeQL. They come in packs. So you can analyze using the pack of the queries, or you can analyze individually. And then talking about code scanning on GitHub, which is to scan your repository or your code base directly on the GitHub platform. Code scanning is a feature on GitHub which is used to analyze code in the GitHub repository to find vulnerabilities and coding errors. It's used to fix and prioritize fixes for existing problems in the source code. And the scanning of your code base on GitHub is usually scheduled and set up in such a way that whenever there's an event, like maybe a push or a merge, the code scanning is triggered to scan the code base for new issues or vulnerabilities in the code base. And so in setting up CodeQL in code scanning on GitHub, there are actually two configurations in CodeQL, which is the default and the advanced setup. We'll get to that. I'll talk about code scanning a bit more later. So let's talk about first setting up CodeQL in VS Code. So, I mean, after you have installed your VS Code, then you go to the extensions view on VS Code software and can use the shortcuts Ctrl+Shift+X. If and on Mac, for Mac users, use the Cmd+Shift+X and then search for CodeQL, then select install. And after installation, it will appear on the side pane when installation is done. And then to add the CodeQL standard query library, which is going to be used as the list of the library of queries that will be used to analyze the code base, you make a lookup of the repo on your computer system, and then go to VS Code, select file, and click on add folder to workspace, and then select the cloned CodeQL folder. And then after selecting it, the query library will appear on the CodeQL extension on the VS Code app application. And then to add the code base now, I mean, I mentioned before that you have to generate a CodeQL database from your code base. So at the CodeQL extension, you go to databases and then you click on databases, and a list of ways to add a database will be listed. That's if a database has not been added already. And during my project, I used the from GitHub option, where after clicking the option, you have to impute the GitHub URL of the repository you're trying to generate a database from. And then you'll be prompted to choose the language which you want to analyze. And the language I was working on was C++. So I chose C++, and database download commenced and was set up. Now going back to CodeQL scanning. I said earlier there are two configuration setups to activate code scanning on your GitHub. That is to automatically scan your repository using and GitHub CodeQL. So there's the default setup for CodeQL, which this default setup automatically chooses the language to be scanned. It chooses the query suites and the triggers that will make CodeQL scanning start in your repo. And then for the advanced setup, this setup is mainly for when you need more control on the configuration. That means you can set up, you're not going to leave the configuration to GitHub to set it yourself. So you can set up the language you want to use, the query suite you want to use, the frequency of the scheduled scan, and what triggers you want for the code scanning to use for when it wants to, for the scheduled scan. And then talking about query suites, during the configuration of code scanning on GitHub, there's two suites of queries that can be used. The first one is default query suites. And the default query suites on CodeQL is this query suites is okay, yes. This query suite houses list of queries that have a higher precision and low false positives. One issue that CodeQL has is false positives, but the default query suite has it has less false positives, and it has a higher precision when it comes to identifying issues in the code base. And then the security extended query suite is a query suite that it holds queries from the default query suite, but then other additional queries that are more serious than what's in the default query suite. But then it has a higher chance of giving false positives. And more details can be found in this link that I provided below. So moving to analyzing the code base. When I started the project, I actually forgot that another configuration, there's a configuration on the repository which used the default query suite. So normally, since I'll be working on analyzing the code scanning had already checked for the queries, analyzed the code base using the queries in the default query suite. So I wasted a bit of time doing the same analysis using the queries from the default query suite. Although I still found some issues, even though I was analyzing using the default query suite. And one of them was tainted arithmetic, which the details for the query is in this link, and it turned out to be a false positive as identified by one of the mentors. So the arithmetic tainted is on arithmetic operations on user control data that are not validated can lead to overflows. So this query identifies such unvalidated user control data, and the unvalidated user control data is this pointer to input. But then we figured out that CodeQL was a false positive because the CodeQL was checking that this was a pointer, but did not take into consideration the definition of the input here, which it was a double pointer. So this was determined to be a false positive. And then after that, I found another issue, which is quite related to arithmetic tainted, the integer overflow tainted, and it was also determined to be a false positive. And yes, because from the details, it's this mask IP, this arithmetic operation here. So the we determine that, okay, if this string char function is actually working properly, which it was working properly, it was not going to cause an overflow. So yes, so this was determined to be a false positive. And then moving on, I found a third issue, missing return value check for a scan flag function. And this one was actually a true positive, and it's this this issue is from this scanf, this SS scanf function, which takes in an input and then tries to match and convert the input to this format specifier. And after converting it, it assigns that value, the converted value, to this variable. Now, this scanf function returns, whenever it's done with this operation, it returns a value which depicts the number of inputs that were successfully converted and assigned. So in this code, the return value will be one, but there was no way for us to validate that, okay, this function successfully processed. So even if it did not go well, this code will still run. So if it's zero, it will still run. So we had to validate the return value. So I did that, but then one of the mentors determined that the scan function, this code here, was actually not necessary because there were other validation of the inputs in prior codes above. So we just removed this whole scan, this whole expression from the code. And yeah, we're done with that. So since in the configuration of code scanning on GitHub had the default query suite, which only had a segment of queries that can be used to analyze the code base, I proposed the inclusion of the security extended query suite to be added to the code scanning configuration of the repository, and it was merged. And after merging, the scheduled scan, the code scanning, actually identified issues and bugs in the repository, and these issues and bugs are being fixed and worked on at the moment. So yes, and then learning outcome during this whole internship, I learned programming in C++. I mean, I'm not very adept in it, but I can actually a bit comfortably read C++ code and write some snippets of C++ code. And I also learned code analysis, especially using CodeQL, and about code security on GitHub and how it works and how it's set up. Also, I learned writing Suricata verify tests to test for the bugs that I found, and I mean after fixing, to test that okay, the code still works. And then I also started writing a blog for the first time, and I wrote a few things on my blog. I still have other things to write, and I'll be doing that. So this is the link to my blog. And also I learned working in a professional environment with a team. I mean, for me, it was not very easy because I'm more introverted and do not really speak much. So at first, it was a bit hard for me, but yeah, I got more comfortable. And thanks to my mentors, they were pretty warm, and yeah, it's all turned out well. So yeah, these are references. This link here houses different information about CodeQL, and this link here houses setting up of CodeQL in Visual Code for those who need. I mean, there are a lot more other details in this link that I did not talk about that could be found here. And also, this is about the whole general code security on GitHub, so it can be found. Yeah, and yeah, this is a link to my blog and my email for those who want to for contacts, and also my Mastodon social media handle. So thank you for your time, and I'll be receiving questions after the whole webinar. So thank you.
Thank you. Congratulations to you and to Hadiqa. Do we have any questions?
No, not yet.
If while we don't see any questions, I would like to add that helping us find bugs and helping us go over code that was merged and maybe wasn't in the best of ways is very important. The SConf issue that Eniola found helped us realize that actually, as he said, we didn't even need that SConf there. And he was the first one to go over the code and analyze it and say, I think we already do the validation, so maybe we don't need that. But as an intern, speaking for myself, we usually don't have all the confidence. So we usually go like, I think, and then we need the mentors to go there and say, yeah, this makes sense. But it also helps us gain the confidence, because next time, I believe that you will feel more confident, right? You will read the code and say, hey, this really looks like this, so we really need this here. And this is part of the learning process, and this is part of this of what this journey is about. And for Hadika's work, we actually prioritized which keywords should be worked on first based on lots of requests. Some of those keywords have been waiting for a long time. The ET folks have asked for them for a long time. And so it's great to see that we have at least two down and more to come. And the way we like to have these webinars is, and you probably noticed that in the way the presentations were organized, is that we want those to be useful in case other folks want to follow on the steps that Hadiqa and Eniola did, and to help complete more of these tasks, right? And in this sense, it's great to see both of your presentations, because you have shared the steps to complete what you did. You have shared how to do the setup. During the contribution phase, Hadiqa identified very correctly that we do not have a tutorial for installing Suricata on macOS, especially from a developer perspective. And she offered herself to write such a tutorial. So this is something that is a work in progress, but it will be very welcome to our community. So yeah, it's there are lots of things that do not show exactly in the presentation, but that happened behind the scenes, and I just wanted to help highlight those things. It is as I am also the coordinator for OISF for this initiative with Outreachy, and it is also many times challenging for us to learn how to better accommodate different needs from the interns. So I would like to thank both of you for your patience with us. And I hope you had a great time. I thank all the folks who joined us today to celebrate the end of your internships. We still have one more day tomorrow, but it's more of a relaxing moment. And yeah, if anyone else from the team, or if you would like to say anything else, please feel free, because otherwise I'll just be here filling up the silence, as you know I do.
Do you mind if I jump in quickly, Juliana?
Please.
So it is no small task on this team to coordinate with our outreachy interns and the outreachy coordinators. And I just have to shout out to Juliana for another great session with outreachy. And I'm, you know, as Juliana's communicated, once you're part of the OISF community, you're always a part. So I hope you guys will stay in touch with us and continue working on Suricata. We'd love to support you in your journeys ahead. So please don't feel like you have to go far. But congratulations, Juliana, for another round of outreachy. Well done, my friend.
Congratulations to all the team. Thank you. But it's really a joint effort because we do need all the mentors to have things working, to review all the PRs and to complement the knowledge that each person has in terms of how to best answer this question, how to best make this topic clear to someone who's new to the team. So for this round, we had Shivani, Victor, Jason, and Philip. It was the first time that Philip was mentoring outreach interns with us, and it was very important to have all of you on board with this, and also, well, of course, the rest of the team as well, who are there to welcome Hadiqa and Yola and to help review PRs and everything. So it's really a team effort, and I'm so glad all of you are there. We usually take this moment as well to wish all the best in your journeys. So whatever you do, we hope you do great. We take this moment to say that we have your back. So if anytime you need us or if anything is going wrong, you know that you have the Meerkats to look after you. So you are part of our Meerkat family, as Kel said. And we will love to hear from your achievements, your successes in life, your journeys in general, and stay in touch. That's it. Our community is yours. We hope to see you live at a certain point. If you manage to join us for Suricon or any other events, we will be so happy to see you. We got the chance to meet Modupe last year. She is, excuse me, also watching this webinar, and it was so good to see her and hug her. So I hope to have that with you too as well. What else?
Juliana, everybody knows where to find the recording, right? We're going to be posting this.
Yes, thank you. Thank you for saying that. Let me just, thank you, Kel. You are always so great. This is it. So I don't have the YouTube link here, I think, but the recording is always shared and published on YouTube, and we will share the link on our socials. This is Twitter and Mastodon or InfoSec Exchange mostly. Join our community if you are not a part of that yet. Our forum is forum.suricata.io. We have our official Discord channel, and you can find anything and more in our webpage, suricata.io. Again, don't forget, we have Suricon this year. We hope to see you there. And yeah, this is mainly it. Kel, sorry for interrupting you, but thanks for reminding me of mentioning our important links. So YouTube is where you will find the webinar. You will find also the slides there, and we will publish when those are ready and available on Twitter and InfoSec Exchange. And this is it. Thanks all for joining. Stay tuned. Join us for Suricon if you can, live or also online. You will be able to watch the talks as well as a virtual attendee. Hello, darkness, my old friend. let us hear your voices one more time before we wrap up the webinar.
Bye, everyone. For having us.
Thank you.
I wanted to talk about the Meerkat pictures I just saw just now. They look cute.
Yeah, you could have used them. I told you that you could have funny pictures, but you didn't believe us. Thanks for overcoming your shyness and stepping up and talking in this webinar. I know it's not easy. It's never easy for me. So congratulations on both of you for doing that. And see you soon, I hope. Thank you all. This is the wrap up of yet another webinar, and stay tuned. We will certainly have more webinars this year. Bye all.
Bye, everybody. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.